So hello students, this is Dr. Viresh Chandra MS, Assistant Professor, Mechanical Engineering Department, Sri Jagadguru Chandrasekharanatha Institute of Technology, Chikbalapur. So under this e-Sikshana program of VTU, I'm here to teach you the second module of kinematics of machines, that is velocity and acceleration analysis of mechanisms, that is using graphical method. Okay, you know the complete syllabus. So this is the second module, and when you complete learning this module, or when you understand each and everything in this module, so you will be able to analyze the velocity and acceleration of a mechanism using graphical method, even by analyzing the individual links. Okay, so that is, so you know what exactly is a mechanism, because see, in the first module itself you have learnt what is a mechanism, what it is made up of. Okay, as you normally know, the mechanism is made up of links, and the links are joined together using a joint. So whenever there is a motion with respect to the link, whenever there is a motion with respect to the link, okay, there will be acceleration, there will be velocity, and there will be acceleration. Correct. So we have to analyze each and every link for its velocity and acceleration. Okay, and that can be done using graphical method. Okay, so after collecting the syllabus, or even whatever we have for the syllabus in the second module, so we can have this outcome for this module, that is students will be able to analyze the velocity and acceleration of a mechanism using graphical method by analyzing individual links. So what exactly is graphical method, and how will we analyze the velocity and acceleration? So that will be taught to you in the upcoming classes. As of now, today, as this is the first class, so we will be discussing about the prerequisites, or some of the basic things we should know in order to understand the analysis of velocity and acceleration. So I have put a animation here which will help you understand the basic terminologies, or even basic definitions which are required in order to understand the next upcoming logics. So let us consider a ball here. When some amount of force is applied on the ball, or when I throw the ball to someone, okay, it will travel to certain distance. That is, there is a change in position of this ball from one point to another point. So it was there previously at a reference point, and that has moved to a new position. So we can say that due to the change in position of the ball, the ball has gained motion. The ball has gained motion. Correct. But the motion, as we know already, it has got no direction. That is, it can move in any path it wants. It can move in any path it wants. If you throw it up, then it will come down. Okay, if you put that on the ground, it will pitch up. If you throw it in a line or linearly, it will move in a line. So it has got no direction. So now we need to talk about the, and when I consider, or when I say motion, so the motion may be translatory motion or rotatory motion. So translatory motion, as you people know, is something which is traveling in a straight line or in a straight path. Rotatory motion is which is having a curved path, which is moving in a curved path. So then what is displacement? Are the both terms, motion and displacement, same? No, obviously they are not. So motion, as I told you, has got no direction. But when I say displacement, okay, so we say that the displacement is the shortest distance between any two positions. Shortest distance between any two positions. That is, the ball has got a reference point initially. It has moved to a new point here. So the shortest distance taken by this ball to reach this new point is nothing but the displacement. And as we know, displacement is a vector quantity, as it has both magnitude and direction. So it can be negative, it can be positive, or it may be sometimes zero, or it may be sometimes zero. If we consider a curved path, okay, it starts from a point and it will come back to that particular point. So it becomes zero then. Okay, and if we consider a linear displacement, so it will go to a certain point, it may come back to the initial position or initial point, so it may become zero then. Correct. So now let us assume that there is still some force acting on the ball. So what will happen? The ball will still travel to some other position. The ball will still travel to some other position with change in displacement. With change in displacement at that particular time. So that is nothing but velocity. So the rate of change of displacement with respect to time is nothing but velocity. Even though in some of the cases, the ball may move with a uniform velocity, then there will be no question of acceleration. But if the velocity changes, then the ball will experience acceleration. The ball will experience acceleration because we know the definition of acceleration. It is the rate of change of velocity with respect to that particular time. So that is acceleration. Okay. In the next slides, we will be discussing about the different types of velocities we have and the different types of accelerations we have. So we will move on to the next slide. So when I talk about velocity, velocity may be linear or angular, correct? The velocity may be linear or angular. If there is a change in linear displacement, yes, which is denoted by S. So that is known as linear velocity. And if there is a change in angular displacement, that is theta, so that is normally known as the angular velocity, but both of them with respect to time. That is, see, you can express the linear velocity as ds by dt. Okay, ds by dt. Change in the linear displacement, yes, with respect to time t. So s is the linear displacement of the link. When I am talking about a mechanism, I'll talk about the links, because the links are moving, hence the mechanism is working, hence the mechanism is producing output. So when I say ds by dt, in this equation s means the linear displacement of the link and t is the time. So when I come to the angular velocity, and it is expressed in meter per second, the SI unit is meter per second. And when I come to the angular velocity, the angular velocity is represented by omega. The angular velocity is always represented by omega, and it is given by d theta by dt. So as we know, theta is the angular displacement. And t is the time. So the rate of change of angular displacement with respect to time is nothing but the angular velocity, and it is given by omega. So, and it is, the SI unit is radians per second. So now let me just consider a link OB. Which rotates at point O. B be any point on the link. Let us consider B as any point on the link. Now let us assume that the B is, or the link, the total link, OB link, is rotating about point O. The length of this link OB is R. And now let us say this is rotating, okay, in the anti-clockwise direction and achieving a new position B dash. So now, as we know, what is angular velocity? Angular velocity is the rate of change of angular displacement, which is given by d theta. So this link is rotating with an angular velocity omega, as shown in the diagram, and has reached a new position B dash. So how will be the linear velocity acting? So the angular velocity is shown here. It is acting anticlockwise, and hence it is being denoted as omega. Now, how will be the linear velocity acting to the link? The linear velocity always acts tangential to the curve produced by the rotary motion of the link. The linear velocity vector always acts perpendicular to the link and tangent to the curve generated during the rotation of this link OB to reach a new position B dash. So that is what is shown in this figure or in the diagram. As you can see, this is V, and there is a relationship between linear velocity and angular velocity. So what is that relation? Omega is equal to V by R. Omega is equal to V by R. So omega, as we know, is the angular velocity, V is the linear velocity, and R is the link length. And R is the link length. Or it can also be written as V is equal to omega into R. V is equal to omega into R. So students, you should remember this formula because it will be helpful for solving the problems. While we will be discussing the problems, I will again explain the relation between the linear and angular velocity. So this is about the velocity. Now, when there is a rate of change of velocity happening, or when the ball is not traveling with a uniform velocity, so there will be a change in velocity, of course. Okay, or else when I say the link is rotating, this link OB is rotating, okay, it is having or it experiences change in velocity, which leads to the acceleration, which leads to acceleration, because acceleration definition already we know that it is the rate of change of velocity with respect to time. So again, in acceleration, we have two types of accelerations, linear acceleration and angular acceleration. So when I say linear acceleration, it is nothing but the rate of change of linear velocity V. It is the rate of change of linear velocity V. It is given by A. And the rate of change of linear velocity will be given by dv by dt. So we know what is v. V is ds by dt. So therefore, A is equal to d square s by dt square. A is equal to d square s by dt square. And the SI unit for the linear acceleration is meter per second square. So when I come to the angular acceleration, it is nothing but the change in or rate of change of angular velocity with respect to time. So that can be easily written as alpha. So it is denoted by alpha, and it can be easily given by d omega by dt, because omega is the angular velocity. So rate of change of angular velocity is nothing but d omega, and with respect to time is dt. So alpha is equal to d omega by dt, but we know that the omega is equal to d theta by dt. Therefore, d by dt of d theta by dt, which gives you the equation for alpha, that is d square theta by dt square. And normally the angular acceleration has got SI units in terms of radians per second square. Radians per second square. Now, this is very important. Kindly concentrate and understand that the acceleration is again separated into two components. Exactly speaking, the acceleration is separated into three components. We will discuss about the third component later in the sessions. But now, for as of now, acceleration is separated into two components. First one is the normal or centripetal or radial acceleration, and the second one is the tangential acceleration. So you need to understand what exactly is normal, centripetal or radial acceleration. So you can give any name for that: normal acceleration, centripetal acceleration, or radial acceleration. And the second one is tangential acceleration. So in order to understand that, we will go step by step using a diagram. Let us consider a link AB. Let us consider a link AB. Okay. Now, link AB is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction. Link AB is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction with an angular velocity of omega and angular acceleration alpha. So I'll repeat once again. So let us consider a link AB, which is free to move, of course, which is free to move, which is not a frame, which is not a fixed link. So it is free to move, and it is rotating anti-clockwise with an angular velocity of omega and with angular acceleration alpha. Okay, now we have to get the velocity for this. As I have already told you, the linear velocity always acts perpendicular to the length, or it will be tangent to the curve generated during the rotation of the link. So this is how we can denote the velocity vector for a point B on link BA. That is, B with respect to A, the rotation of B with respect to A, okay, has got some velocity. So velocity of B with respect to A is denoted like this. That is perpendicular to the link. Okay, now and it should be directed like that only. As given in the diagram, it should be directed like that. When we solve the problems, we will clearly discuss about the sense in which the velocity vectors have their directions. Okay, so direction for the velocity vector of B with respect to A is given like this. It is because the link is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction. So in the same direction, you have to sense the velocity of the point B with respect to A. Now, as I have already told you, there are two components, that is radial component or centripetal component, or we can say that as normal component of acceleration. When there is a change in magnitude of the velocity, then you experience the tangential acceleration. Okay, so when there is a change in magnitude of the velocity, you are going to experience the tangential acceleration, and the tangential acceleration component acts perpendicular to the link or in the direction of the velocity, in the direction of the velocity vector. So that is why it has been shown like this. ATBA, as you can see, ATBA is the line drawn exactly on the line representing vector BA, that is velocity vector BA. Okay, so the tangential acceleration is nothing but the change in magnitude of velocity. Okay, and when you consider the radial acceleration component or centripetal acceleration component or normal acceleration component, so it is experienced when there is a change in the direction of velocity. So this, how does this radial acceleration component acts? So this acts exactly towards the point of rotation, or you can draw a line and represent the radial acceleration component. You can draw a line and represent a radial acceleration component parallel to the link, or radial acceleration component is perpendicular to the velocity vector as well as the tangential acceleration vector. Okay, so and the relation in order to find out the radial component is omega square into r, where omega is nothing but the angular velocity and r is the link length. Now when you consider the tangential acceleration, how to find out tangential acceleration? So tangential acceleration can be found out by using the relation ATBA is equal to alpha into r. So as of now, this much is enough for the basics. So in the next session, we will be discussing about the different methods which are used in order to analyze velocity and acceleration of the mechanisms. So thank you, students.